DJ Valentino here with Paolo from Trivium. How you doing today, Paolo?
Doing very well. Just another day in quarantine. How you doing over there?
I'm doing okay. Just trying to hunker down. How are you passing the time in quarantine?
Kind of a mix of obviously doing press for the new record, which the last few weeks there's been quite a bit. Also trying to get a little bit of home workouts in to kind of make sure I don't come out of this gaining a lot of extra weight from all the food that I've been eating. And now I just started bass lessons today and songwriting stuff. So that's been kind of a nice thing to add to, being at home since we can't rehearse right now. It's kind of getting me, practicing myself and then also just helping people out with their playing.
Yeah, I definitely saw that. How, what inspired you to do Skype lessons and Skype teaching?
I had always thought about it in the past. It was really just a schedule thing. I feel like I was never at home long enough to really make it worth it. And, I just didn't have a good time for it. Like, I wanted to be able to like give people like a proper, hour lessons and stuff and not have to kind of rush things through. So now that I have plenty of time on my hands, I was able to kind of set it up. Alex has actually been doing lessons on drums for quite a bit. And so that was definitely gave me a little inspiration to do some myself. And it's actually kind of a nice way to just kind of, explain songwriting and bass playing to people that maybe have different skill levels. And in a way, it's good for me because I have to kind of think it through and explain it to people that maybe don't understand, like, if they're not like a super advanced player, if I start saying something, they might not understand it. So I have to really break it down to like fundamental levels. And it's kind of fun to do that. Kind of a challenge, so I'm enjoying that so far.
Yeah, they say by explaining it to other people, you really, really cement, the knowledge. That's super cool. I can imagine a fan of Trivium, if they've listened to you guys for years and years, it's got to be like a dream come true to have like a Skype lesson with their idol. That's got to be a really awesome experience for them.
I definitely want I want it to be, something fun for people. And hope, that they get something out of it. I'm looking forward to like more of the songwriting stuff because I feel like that's some place that I can really help a lot of people, especially if they have like bands and stuff, to kind of give them some of the knowledge that I've learned working, in the studio and working with the other guys, just kind of what we've done to kind of take our music to the next level. And I'm always happy to kind of give those things out to people. I don't feel like it's like a secret that we have to hold on to because at the end of the day, someone's got to write their own lyrics and they got to write their own music. But if I can kind of give them a couple like key tips to like, oh, how you could maybe enhance a song a little bit, like I'd love to do that and love to like help people to get their bands, to another level and get them off the ground and doing what they love to do.
Definitely, definitely. And if you can give your wisdom onto these young musicians, then that's just going to be more music out in the field, and then the music scene as a whole is going to thrive, So it just.
I definitely want to do that. One of the people that hit me up was actually they had opened up a show that I had went to like a year or two ago, and they actually sent me there some demo material and some stuff they had done so I could kind of like listen to it a little bit beforehand and kind of have something to listen to kind of like maybe not pick apart in like a bad way, but be like, hey, maybe you could do some stuff like this. This would help here and there. And that's going to be really fun to do, kind of give them I guess maybe my producer's opinion on things.
Definitely. And especially with like Trivium, you guys have like almost tackled so many different subgenres of metal with every album. So I'm sure you're so well versed in the rock scene as a whole that regardless of what genre of rock people give you, you can work with and, provide insight.
You can really I mean, all the music, it's all the same notes. It's a lot of the same concepts and ideas, maybe just kind of approach from a different angle. But I feel like, we all really stay in touch with like what's going on with the metal scene and the rock scene. Like I love finding new bands. So, it's gonna be cool to maybe talk with some people that like, maybe play metal, but it's a little bit different, maybe from a different genre and see what we could talk about and figure out. And that's for me, I mean, I hope to learn a lot from different people, from like talking to them about how they play music and stuff like that. So I'm stoked for it because, obviously we're gonna have some time off from touring and we do a lot of meet and greets and stuff. We get to meet people. So this is kind of taking the place of that where I can kind of still meet with fans, talk to them and, you know, especially with like a whole hour, you can really kind of have someone like pick my brain and I can really pick theirs and figure out like, you know, what they're trying to get out of the situation.
Definitely. And, you know, you mentioned that these are really weird times. I definitely want to talk to you about how is it to release an album like in this time frame? This is really just unprecedented. Nothing like this has happened in our lifetimes. And you guys, you know, you maintain that album release date and you did the whole album rollout process. But while everyone was in quarantine, you know, you couldn't do like shows to hype up the release. How was that like?
I mean, once we had to start like canceling shows, like we canceled our Asian tour, we canceled the European press trip. You know, we realized really quickly that we were going to have to adapt to this. And I feel like for us, we took it as a sort of a challenge. You know, this is for everyone in the business. This is unprecedented. You know, touring is such a crucial aspect of like promoting a record that it's almost impossible to think that we could put out a record and not have any touring possibly. But we're a band that likes to take these kind of challenges and try to be creative and adapt to them. And so far, you know, I feel like we've done a pretty good job and we've done our best to like really be out there promoting it online as best we can. You know, obviously with Matt on Twitch, you know, he's pretty much daily out there kind of pushing things on that end. And then we have like our virtual events that we were able to pull off with like the virtual CD signing. We did an interview with Josh Wilbur, who produced the record. And we did an interview with the guy that did all the videos for the record, Ryan McFall. So, you know, that was just kind of a start for us. We have a lot of things in the works that we're trying to plan out right now. And some of it's going to come down to just being able to travel again to at least rehearse and do some stuff when we can all be in Orlando together. But we're, you know, this is definitely not an end for us for promoting the record. And if we're not touring for, you know, a couple months or a year, whatever it is, we're going to prepare for that. And, you know, we're not going to just kind of sit around and wait.
Definitely. And you mentioned, you know, Matt obviously has his Twitch thing and he's done Twitch streams of like practices and warm-ups and you guys have done like little shows on Twitch. So you guys are no stranger to kind of this live stream show environment. A lot of bands are being thrust into this for the first time. How do you feel kind of adapting in ways that you've already maybe are a little bit more comfortable with?
I guess like the next part from here is we're going to have to, again, when we can travel, we can be together, we can rehearse. You know, we have some ideas for events we'd like to do where it comes to streaming and full band type performances that we're working on, like the logistics and how we'll pull it off. You know, a lot of it's really engagement. Of course, like we could do the show and just kind of, you know, people watch us and that would be awesome. But I think something we'd like to do maybe in a couple months, you know, once we get past maybe the first big event we pull off, is doing more like intimate in the rehearsal room type stuff where we can do like special sets that we wouldn't maybe do a whole tour of. You know, maybe it's a cover set, maybe it's a B-side set, maybe it's like deep cuts from the record, and you know, not just play the show but also like engage a little bit more, because the one thing that's a big part of Twitch and streaming is like the engagement between you know, the streamer and the audience in the chat room. And of course, Matt's had a real kind of leg up on that kind of stuff, because we've been doing that for like 3 years now. And, you know, Matt's been on there and really kind of knows how to work that. So if we can incorporate the more fan engagement side of things into our streaming sets, that would be a really fun thing to do. And I think, again, we're all kind of like on the fly trying to like put together how a band exists without regular touring. So we have to make it fun and interesting. And, you know, if you keep doing the same thing over and over, kind of gets old. So we're going to have to kind of try to find a new spin on things as we go along.
Definitely. And I know that Trivium is one of those bands that even before, obviously, you know, the whole coronavirus like shut everything down, your fan engagement has always been like a top priority. You guys really take the fans, you take time for the fans, you know, and it shows in times like this, you know, where you're doing your Skype lessons, you know, Matt's doing like the Twitch stuff, and you guys are interacting in ways that the fans can really kind of gravitate towards. And I'm sure that they love it, especially in this time frame where everyone's so down and, you know.
I mean, you have to kind of, I mean, for us, like that was like putting out the album was a big part of that. We didn't want to let people down. with having to push stuff back. We were willing to kind of sacrifice, you know, when it came to maybe the first week side of things, which ultimately, funny enough, we ended up charting for the first time in a lot of countries that we've never charted in, charting at our highest position. So I guess the gamble on that end sort of paid off, but that was sort of like a secondary thing because people being able to get the music was the most important thing. And, you know, it's nice having it out there and people being able to listen to it and learn it and, you know, getting the feedback from fans. And that's kind of made us more excited to kind of get in to the rehearsal spot and try to like figure out ways to kind of entertain people while, you know, everyone's at home or, you know, kind of just dealing with the situation as it's unfolded. And yeah, it's been crazy, but you know, we're going to pull through it. You know, not just our band, but like, I think everyone, like we have to, there's no way around it. So, you know, in the meantime, it's just finding ways to keep people entertained and keep music coming out.
And one thing that I noticed, especially with this record release, is that the positive response has been absolutely overwhelming. I've seen hundreds and hundreds of reviews and fans, and they're all praising this record, and they absolutely love it. And I think, obviously, this is a very kind of like a dark time, and people are really feeling it. Things are looking bleak. You know, this lockdown open release date keeps getting pushed back and back and back. And this record has some very kind of dark themes on it. The instrumentation is very dark. I think something with this record sonically really, really resonated with people. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I think as it became apparent that what was happening and as we started to release like the first single or two, it seemed like people were starting to pick up on like this sort of connection with the events that were happening. And I guess you can never really anticipate things like happening all of a sudden to kind of make the music even more of a, you know, resonant to people. You know, but I think it's been interesting because like as people have had time to listen to the record and, you know, even for us, like getting to re-listen to the record as things have unfolded, it's kind of given lyrics maybe an additional meaning than their original meaning, if that makes sense. But it's been great. And, you know, there's not a lot of records coming out now. So we kind of have people's undivided attention, which has, I guess, has been kind of a positive side effect maybe of what's happening now, like to have so many people's attention, like whether they're at home or, you know, working kind of still going to work, but like, you know, needing something to listen to. We really have never had this sort of attention from people before.
Definitely, definitely. And you're right. I know that so many album release dates have been pushed back, like for so many records, all the way into like December for a lot of them. And some of them I understand, you know, like a lot of these records, they can't even get the physical CDs or vinyls out because of everything that's being shut down. Yeah. I know that our WSOU merch, like if you can buy merch from us, yeah, but our warehouse is being shut down right now because of the whole coronavirus. So it's just, it's definitely tough, but I think it's absolutely awesome that you guys were able to still pull through and make this release as awesome as it is.
Yeah, I mean, the physical production side of things was definitely, you know, we kind of lucked out because a lot of our stuff was already made for people that had pre-ordered. But of course, you know, people are still ordering stuff. So at the moment, it seems like that end of things is still up and running. And of course, it could change at any moment. But I think fans are understanding that if like there are delays and stuff, there's really, it's out of our hands. You know, getting it online was sort of the more important thing because people could stream right away, even if they had ordered records and stuff like that. And, you know, it's a gamble kind of either way because, you know, there's no guarantee that things are going to be better in like a couple months, like summertime or even by winter of next year, which, you know, it's kind of a crappy thing to think about, but there's no way around it. Like it's a possibility. So the gamble was release on time and maybe take a hit or hold back till later and still take that hit. And then you've like lost a lot of time and maybe momentum. And it wasn't something we were willing to kind of to deal with because, you know, we're just kind of planning as if things are kind of on schedule in terms of releasing the record and we'll promote it as best we can for as long as we can. And then, you know, we'll start thinking about another record. We didn't want to hold up that process, you know, because we'll come out of this at some point, you know, but we don't want to be too far behind with making new music.
And especially like, if like you as the band had worked your heart and soul into this record and you're mm-hmm. so proud of it, and then you're ready to release it and you have to sit on it for like, you know, 9 months, yeah. 10 months and you want to get it to the fans, but you can't, you know, and that's also going to be, a really bad thing. So it's a good thing that you guys.
Yeah, we definitely needed to. We definitely needed to do that.
Mm. So now another question that I have, I mentioned this a little bit before the interview started, but Trivium, what I love about you guys, every single record that you release, it feels like it's your best record to that date. Like mm-hmm. I've never felt like you guys have kind of like, you know, not put 100% into every yeah. record that you've released. And especially like, you know, obviously every record you've done, it sounds original. It sounds like Trivium, the next evolution of Trivium. Mm-hmm. So the question I kind of have is, do you still take influences from other artists, or do you just focus on, okay, this is Trivium, we have to make an evolution of this record into the next record?
I mean, we definitely still listen to a lot of new bands, and I find inspiration in finding new bands still. I think I don't know, like, there's this sort of, like, maybe it's just kind of one of those things when, like, you've been around a bit, you don't want to, like, kind of, like, admit that, like, hey, you still find inspiration in new bands, and there's nothing wrong with that. Like, I don't want to be a band that's just, like, kind of frozen in time with our influences and our, you know, what the way we think about music. You know, it doesn't necessarily mean I listen to a new band and then I want Trivium to sound like a different genre. You know, we're not going to insert ourselves into like a new sort of scene or movement. But what I kind of take from that is like, you know, what's making that music exciting? What do I like about it? You know, are they doing something cool with like riffs or drums or just the way they present themselves? Like that is something that I like to still discover in bands. And you know, I remember being a young kid and like finding Metallica and stuff like that and how exciting that was. And so, you know, you really can't ever shut that off. I think if you want to do this like long term, you got to find like new sources of inspiration. And, you know, of course, Metallica puts out a new record every, you know, couple years, maybe if you're lucky. But it's like you got to have more than just those early days of like what got you into it. You got to keep finding stuff and discovering things. And then in turn, it helps us to when we go into a rehearsal room, you know, if we're still listening to new stuff, we're still kind of vibing out on bands coming out. Like, I feel like it kind of inspires us to want to create new things and to keep pushing ourselves and not like feel like we've reached like this pinnacle where we can just kind of take a break. You know, we feel like we're only as good as the record we have put out. You know, this record, as well reviewed as it is, and hopefully whenever we get on tour, as well received as it is by fans live, you know, the next step, it's like we're going to have to do this all over again. And you can't count on that goodwill of a record holding over to the next one. It has to, you start again, you have to build it back up. And you have to, I feel like I always just am like, you know, each record really counts. And it's like the more you make and the longer you've been around, you know, the less like the hype around things matters and the more like the music matters most. You know, that's what gets us the most attention is the record.
And I've asked a few artists this question, and something you said just kind of like triggered it in my mind. You know, obviously how these records are received live is different. And when you're playing a show live, there's this awesome like cycle of energy where you get pumped up and the crowd gets pumped up and then you feed off the crowd's energy
yeah.
and the crowd feeds off your energy. And it's the super awesome like cycle of energy that makes the live concert so incredible. When you're doing these streamings, there's no real, mm-hmm. not that there's no interaction, but it's a lot less. It's a lot immediate. You know, you might do a live stream, you'll see a ton of hearts kind of pop up.
Yeah.
But that's not the same as the energy of the crowd right there in front of you. How do you kind of adapt that when you're doing these live stream shows?
I mean, it's going to be interesting to do. I think, you know, maybe we'll figure out a way to like, we can like take one of those big like, you know, screens or like a computer or something to be able to like see the interaction type of thing and figure out a way to kind of like, you know, vibe off of that. And like, maybe, I don't know, just kind of try to think about it like in a different way. I guess it's like when you're like making a music video and there's no one there and it's just a camera, you have to kind of exude some sort of energy and charisma to nothing, to a lens. So I guess in a way you will have to approach it like that. Plus, just knowing that people are there and watching, having to kind of figure out a way to get them engaged and entertained while we're doing that. I think we're up for the challenge because, you know, we've been doing this quite a while. you know, we've had a, like a head start with the Twitch stuff, and we're just going to see where we can go with that.
Definitely, definitely. And now something really cool also about like this record and every Trivium record, the album artwork and the color scheme, it just fits the song so perfectly. Like when I hear these songs, that's the kind of album cover I would picture, even if I hadn't seen the album cover. When you're writing a record, do you have a huge say in the album cover, or do you just kind of submit it to artists and they kind of do their own thing with it?
I mean, we have total control over our stuff now. You know, Roadrunner really trust us with like the entire project. You know, they really, I think just from delivering albums over the year, over the years that have really, you know, we've hit the mark on. So they kind of know, okay, Trivium's going to put their all into it. They know what they're doing. You know, we'll give them our feedback and we work together, you know, but we let them kind of do their thing when it comes to music, art, to kind of get started. You know, when we start, we kind of have a couple ideas maybe of what we'd like to do with art, but I think we've realized that with art and with album titles, you have to really do the music first before you can really, you know, solidify what you're going to do, because the music's changing constantly, lyrics are changing, and so the ultimate presentation of like art and stuff was going to change as well. And the way we actually did the record this time, album art wise, was we actually did photos first with this this dude named Mike Dunn that we really loved his work. He was a local Orlando guy, and he did the photos, and we loved them so much that we asked him if he would do maybe an album cover with some of the like images and stuff that he had kind of had in some of our photos, because he kind of does this like kind of old-timey kind of folk style of photography, and he mostly does a lot of folk and country bands. So it was kind of this interesting art, like, you know, with all these like flowers, kind of dead flowers and all this stuff. And that was kind of what inspired us to maybe try something with that. And so he went and did like hours of photos with like maybe 500-600 different types of flowers in different states of being, like whether they're on fire, whether they had like some sort of paint or something on them or something like affecting them. And we went through all of those and we found this one photo that was the perfect one. And it was the only one that looked like that. And we just loved it. We loved how it looked. And we felt like it really fit the title of the record, What the Dead Men Say. You know, that was kind of even tricky because we didn't want to do like something that was like very obvious, like with a title, What the Dead Men Say, like, you know, gravestones or something. So we had to kind of try to get as creative with it as we could. And you know, sometimes when you work with people that are just really talented at what they do and their art form, you can kind of give them a little bit of inspiration of what you're looking for, and you just let them run with it, and a guy like that just comes back with, you know, tons of stuff. I mean, we had so many great photos from him, and you know, that's why we love working with all these artists. You know, they know it better than us, you know, when it comes to presenting our music in visual or whatever their art form is.
That's awesome. I love it. I love it. That's so cool. Another thing that I definitely want to touch upon is The Defiant is the song of the new record. It's in our new music at, you know, at the top of every hour. Killer. You know, we're playing it nonstop. We absolutely love it. We know that the fans have really gravitated towards it as well. Is there any sort of insight that you could give into like the writing process of that song, the recording process of that song, any kind of behind the scenes stuff?
Yeah, we brought that, or I should say Matt brought the demo in for that song. You know, we had jammed it, like, essentially we broke up our writing into three sessions where we would do like three or four songs at a time so we can kind of really focus on stuff. And in the second session, we started The Defiant, or what would become it. We didn't have any lyrics for it yet. We just really started the music. And so we recorded like the original version of it, and it was cool. But I think over the course of a few weeks of like getting to like live with it for a bit, one thing I kind of felt, and I brought it up and I think everyone agreed, was like, we felt like the vibe of like where it should go wasn't there. And I think part of it was like, because the album, or the song, I should say, kind of had this sort of almost throwback ascendancy type vibe. I think the initial demo was consciously trying not to do that. And I felt like when we came back to work on it again, we kind of leaned into it a little bit more and it worked better. It just immediately like throwing screaming over the verses, speeding things up, just kind of like just throwing you know, what we do best at it, you know, playing fast, being a little bit more progressive and intense. And it just made the song come to life. And it was really fun because you really get like a before and after look of like how a song could have gone. Like, and if we would have went with the original, maybe it wouldn't have been as popular with people. Maybe it wouldn't have like had that kind of spark to it. And, you know, when you're writing, it's kind of like, you have to kind of feel those moments out. Like if it doesn't feel right to you, like you gotta try something else. And I do feel like our kind of our sense for things like that has gotten a lot better. And when it feels like we're not on the right path, we just kind of change course and we don't even like think twice about it.
And I absolutely love that. I know. I hope once tours are allowed again, we really, really hope to see that song.
Oh yeah. It'll be in the set for sure.
Awesome. So is there ever like a time when you talked about that feeling and when you know a song is okay, this is, it's where it needs to be. Mm-hmm. Is there ever a time when there's maybe different opinions like with band members? Maybe one band member is like, oh my gosh, we found it. This is it. Yeah. And then another band member is like, oh, not at all. We need to rework this.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like through the whole rehearsal and writing process, you kind of get those moments where, you know, there's maybe a disagreement on where things can go, but the way we've really, we handle those situations is we try all of the ideas. And now with Alex in the band, I feel like we could throw out like 10 different ideas of the same part. And because he's able to really pick up on things quick, we can try them all. We don't have to like, you know, sacrifice like, well, this would really take a long time to try. We just do it. And I feel like you kind of, most of the times, like you'll try a bunch of ideas. And I think once you've actually tried someone's idea before you said no, you end up kind of working out the right part. You know, I think you have to kind of give everyone their say with their idea. If someone like gives you an idea, you should try it. Like if you just say no right away, like in the past, I feel like, you know, that's how it used to be. It's like, no, like my idea is better. You know, I don't want to try that. And like now we don't fight those kind of things. We try them first. And if there still is a disagreement, you kind of find a perfect balance between that. And I mean, when I bring in a song, I want people's playing to really shape the stuff. So I try not to like stick to the demos I bring in so hard, you know, like maybe I'll have a cool riff I like, but we'll develop it. And I want to have Corey's input, Matt's input, Alex's input, because that's what turns it into like a really fun song for people to listen to. You know, it's not just a solo project for one person. It's everyone having to kind of collaborate. And, you know, you'll learn over time as you make records, the more you collaborate, you know, the better the idea becomes. If you hear any of our demos by themselves, you'll hear riffs that you remember and you know, but like the song doesn't sound like what it becomes because it takes everyone's individual input to really make them the way they turn out.
Definitely, definitely. So now, my last question for you today. Thank you so much again for talking with me. Yeah. We really appreciate it here at WSOU. What is one thing you want fans to take away from this new album, What the Dead Men Say? What's kind of the message that you want to give the fans?
I mean, I guess like with everything that's going on, I would say the message of the record is like, you know, perseverance. I do feel like this record and the last record is a real new kind of era for our band. I think having Alex in the band, working with Josh as a producer, has really kind of given us a whole new sense of purpose and momentum as a band. And, you know, putting a record out in the middle of the pandemic with really an uncertain future, you know, we have to kind of depend on one another to get through this as a band. And of course, for our fans and stuff, you know, it's, I hope that it can just show that, hey, like, you know, when things aren't really going well, you can still find a way through it. And it depends on working with other people. I mean, that's how we're going to get through this. Like if our band wasn't as tight as we are, if we didn't have a great management label and all of our booking agents, you know, this could be detrimental to us. And, you know, we're very fortunate that we have that and we have that strong bond between all of us. So I hope, hoping it'd be a little bit of an inspiration to people out there, you know, just putting out the record and carrying on through it all.
Yeah, definitely. And I know that Matt said in a podcast recently that you guys are taking care of your crew, you know, even in this time frame, you know, paying them for tours that they might not have been able to go, that, you know, that they were supposed to get paid for. So I think that that's also super awesome and deserves recognition that, you know, you guys are still helping them out. Because a lot of music crew and merch guys and lighting guys are suffering.
Terrible. I mean, that, you know, that's a really, it's a tricky thing because, like, you know, the touring really, it's, of course, you know, a big source of our income, but for crew, I mean, that's the main thing. And their side work when they go home, when they're off tour, a lot of those things are shut down too. So, you know, when we had to cancel our tour in Asia, we were just really, you know, of course, for ourselves and our fans, we felt terrible, but like our crew, that's their work, you know, and we had to kind of cut 2 weeks of their work out from the year. And, you know, obviously we wanted to kind of be able to do right and kind of give them some money, even though we weren't going to do the tour. And, you know, I wish it could have been even more than what we were able to do. But, you know, as we start coming back together for events and stuff, as it's safe enough to do, you know, we're going to bring our crew in so that we can give them work and make sure that, you know, they're still taken care of even through all of this stuff. It's tricky, you know, and if you can support your favorite bands, if they're doing anything for their crew, or if you could support local venues and their staff, you know, when things come back, you don't want to have it to where all of these great venues are going under or just owned by the same companies, you know. So if you want or care about anything like that, definitely look into that and support whoever it is, whatever band or venues you can.
Definitely, definitely. I couldn't agree more. Well, thank you so much again for talking with me today. What the Dead Men Say is available on all streaming platforms right now. You can listen to it on virtually anything. You know, we really can't wait to hopefully see you out on tour again soon. Yeah,
definitely. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the interview, and thank you for, you know, promoting us throughout the years and spinning this new record.
Yeah, thank you so much.